Moore hated the rust bucket of a bath, but it was still preferable to cutting your feet on the rocky beach again. Miri retrained herself to play the cello after the fungus ate her arm. Moore never found the right moment to say how impressed she was. Moore remembers watching the stars streak across the sky, Miri's face lit by the moonlight, full of wonder, both wrapped up warm in their duvets, their shared silence saying everything they needed. Moore and Miri had a system for the beds, but now, Miri always sleeps on the top bunk. Miri prefers her tea dark and bitter, to wake her in the early hours. Moore would much rather sleep in and stuff herself with the sugary walnut cookies. That one is Fridolin, Moore recalls. The one that runs away. Fridolin will escape again, but he just needs his own space. Moore can sympathize with that. I won't be here when you come back. I'll leave you on this forsaken piece of rock. How many times has Miri threatened to disappear? Not once going through with her word. She always comes around in the end. For a moment, Moor regrets not going back to get her mask, but she's never been one for moving backwards. Even in this vision, conjured by the fungus in her lungs, the way out is forward. The lighthouse that once brought travelers home, trade to these islands, and customers to the tavern, now stands still. Before she left, the lightkeeper's wife loved to paint. Mor always admired her skill. Her things were left behind in haste, and he never touched them since. Mor can see Hymer from here. She wonders if the lights are on in their tiny house. The gate to the lighthouse. As long as Mor can remember, the lightkeeper was always on duty, saving sailors from the sharp rocks surrounding these islands. But since the Great Exodus, he has been drowning, touching glasses with whatever phantoms are left at that watering hole. steep slope awaits inside the cave. Its ground was a friendly acquaintance to many drunk patrons. Miri has come to her senses. Mole will have some stew. She remembers playing with his son, how they would swim between the rocks, how his wife would bring them inside and warm them up with a bowl of soup and her smile. Moore wonders if he remembers too. Only a ghostly murmur from under his mask. And a ghastly stench. A key glimmering in his satchel. Thank you. A hole in the floor, too big for one man to fill alone. A gaping maw, slowly devouring both man and lighthouse. And still, he stubbornly refuses to accept anyone's help.
Thank you.
A barbed nostalgia sharply tugs at Moore's heart. I forgot how much I missed the sky and stars. His wife wouldn't risk losing the boy to the Blight, but he decided to remain this island's lightkeeper, unable to bear losing what purpose he thought he had. So they set sail without a father. A gentle vertigo crawls over Moore's body, the satisfying tingle of light danger, one of her favorite sensations. Maw takes in a final breath of Leusa's air. Much better, she congratulates herself. Now your chickens can come back out, sister. She does not expect gratitude from her sister, or an apology, but Maw does expect to be welcomed home. Now that the air is safe to breathe again, Miri must have calmed down and gone to make sure that the stew is still warm. Food is always her way of apologizing.